Welcome to the Popcorn Talk Network, for the online broadcast network that features movie discussion, news, and interviews. Press one.
Popcorn Talk. We talk movies. From the Popcorn Talk Network, the online broadcast network for movie talk, this is Inside the Documentary, featuring breakdowns and interviews about all the latest documentaries.
Hello and welcome to Popcorn Talks Inside the Documentary, where we'll be discussing the trials and tribulations of documentary filmmaking. I'm your host, Kristen Elizabeth Snyder. You can follow me at Cinematic Escape. You can follow the Popcorn Talk at the Popcorn Talk on Twitter and Instagram. And joining me...
Hello, everybody. My name is Ryan Mallady, and you can keep up with me at Ryan Mallady.
Hey, guys. I'm Bobby DeMiro. How you doing?
Today, we are discussing Going Clear, the Scientology documentary that HBO made. Initial thoughts, guys. I personally was scared, and I've always wanted to, like, sort of crash those parties in Hollywood when I see the big Hollywood Scientology parties, because it's always been a mystery to me. And after watching this, I feel so informed, and even I'm scared now, sort of, to like bring this up in conversation, obviously, after watching this, what it has done to well-known stars that we all know, what it has done to journalists who have tried to talk about it. What were your initial thoughts?
Scientology is the greatest, and it changed my life for the better. No, I mean, you're right, it is kind of scary because this
Ryan's
whole...
drinking Kool-Aid right now.
It's, yeah, I was thinking it is kind of nerve-wracking talking about this religion. I guess we'll call it a religion. Knowing so much after watching the documentary how many negative consequences can come from speaking out against this powerhouse of a cult. I guess we can also call it a cult now, mm-hmm. too. So I'm kind of nervous talking about it myself.
I, to be honest, wasn't that surprised by it. And I am no Scientology expert, but I've read the normal stuff that we've all probably read about Scientology. And watching it was real well done. I enjoyed the documentary a lot, but I'm looking at it and I'm like, where's the new information? You know, maybe I know more than the average person about Scientology. I don't think so. Like, I knew about L. Ron Hubbard. I knew about all kind of the Xenu story that we'll talk about. Like, I knew the persecution that they do of former members and stuff. And it's interesting to put faces on there of people who have been in it. But as a whole, I'm looking at the documentary and I'm like, okay, that's great. But I don't know if it necessarily broke new ground. I think this is stuff that's been talked about before. It's just a reinforcement of that.
Sure. Right. So I think that's fair.
You know, and maybe because of the venue and because of, you know, HBO and all this sort of stuff, maybe this quote unquote breaks new ground in the sense that it gets another audience that isn't like me or like us that doesn't know about Scientology, or maybe it, you know, pushes over the edge to have a more serious conversation about Scientology or whatever. But for me personally, it was like, okay, this is what I expected.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess for the most part, yeah, Scientology does get a pretty weird reputation. Right, because it's very extreme beliefs once they're exposed. I mean, we're talking about the Xenu stuff, the really outrageous stuff, but the whole documentary starts off at a pretty unbiased pace.
Right.
Sorry.
I mean, I honestly felt like the average person, yeah, I can understand how their tactics in the beginning would help someone going through a traumatic experience or who has been through one, because they sort of do this auditing process, which is sort of like counseling, which actually gets you to sort of reflect on a traumatic experience you've had and take away the emotions that you felt about that situation and any sort of negative emotion, which I just try to do in my normal life, realizing that's helpful to do. But I understand how people kind of started in this society, getting dragged into it, thinking, you know, with these Freudian concepts that have been proven that counselors use, that's how they kind of tricked people using like the bait and switch. It's like, you don't find out till 8 years later, once you've climbed up this ladder, is when you find out, you know, that you get this handwritten story that, Ryan, do you want to go through with the Xanu?
Before you do it, I think that's the biggest issue that you hit on to talk about is the bait and switch.
Yeah.
It's Scientology is just like self-help books, is just like Oprah, is just like Dr. Phil. In you have these, you know, bite-sized snacks of information. Well, you can clear your mind, you can do this, the reactive mind. And for people who are vulnerable to that in the first place, like Paul Haggis was, when they interviewed him, he says, hey, I like this self-help stuff. We can use this self-help stuff. You know, when you get to the book, it's fucking crazy, which is what he said. But It's those first couple things. If you're, you know, inclined to look towards self-help, which I am not, but a lot of people are. A lot of people, you know, follow Oprah, and it's a different level from Scientology. Mm-hmm. But that's the same broad idea. It's self-help. It's what you can do. Here are three easy steps. Here's 10 easy ways. Pay this for this conference, and you get this. No, that's not the way life works, but that's what people mm-hmm. want. And then in Scientology, they flip the real bait and switch on you, which is after three levels or whatever it is. Then it gets crazy, and then you're in too deep. That's the biggest thing is the bait and switch. It's not a religion, and I think you wouldn't even call it a cult in some ways. It's mm-hmm. more of like a self-help plan gone way wrong.
Yeah. Right? To the point that the members are threatened to stay in, that you can't get out, or your family members could be hurt, your animals could be hurt.
And then at that point, it becomes that cultish thing that people can debate about. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. You get tangled up real quick. You start off, it is self-help. It's all about self. And you're paying for even Haggis said, you know, you'll pay for these sessions. And yeah, that one made a lot of sense. It made me feel really good. I reflected and I meditated and everything that you get out of therapy. But then the next step, they're mentioning these weird things that don't really make much sense. But hey, I already paid for the next session, so I'll just go to that too. And you get to the point where it's almost you're invested in your time, your energy, mm-hmm. and your money. And now it's not just you that you're involved with, it's a community, because once you're involved, you know, it's like a fraternity. That's all you hang out with is other Scientologists, and that's all you're talking about is Scientology themes, and you become, it becomes your life.
And the psychology of that is fascinating, in that, you know, you can't lose 15 pounds in 6 days with this one easy trick, and you can't make more money by doing you can't do those things, just like you can't do this. You can't, you know, turn off the reactive mind with two easy conferences at Scientology. You can't do it, but there are people who believe that you can. There will always be people who want to take that shortcut, and Scientology, like all these other self-help things, preys upon them in really the same way to start. And then you almost get so deep in, like we're talking about, that you have to double down on it because you don't mm-hmm. want to look like an idiot.
Exactly.
You don't want to be the guy who's like, oh, this is a bunch of crap, but I put in so much money already, it's not going to work. You have to double down. You lie to yourself. They're finding people very specifically. They're not going after everybody. I mean, I know they mm-hmm. are open. This is open and they want as many as they can get, but they're really finding people very specifically who have very specific neuroses, because those are the people that this is going to work on.
Paranoias?
Absolutely. Those are the people that this is going to work on. And it does, and then you get them to that, past that vulnerable point, and they're in so deep they can't get out, and they begin lying to themselves about it. And the people who were interviewed on this documentary, you know, Paul Haggis and the Spanky Taylor is a great example.
Yeah.
They literally look brainwashed for a long time. She almost alluded to the fact that she was brainwashed for a while, and then one day she's like, what am I doing? You know, wait a second, I got to get out of here, and then makes a literal mad dash for it.
Right. Yes.
Like, if that doesn't tell you something, you know, and we can look at Scientology and say, that's ridiculous, we'd never do that. There's tons of people out there who are on that vulnerable level, who you catch them at the right time in the right situation with the right promise, they're in.
I mean, I would kind of compare it to the people who will constantly order those things on the 1-800 channel where it's like, oh, you need this knife that'll literally cut through everything. It's like, my father is one of those people, and it's like, literally, he buys all that stuff off those channels, and it's like he never opens it, never needs it, but they convince him that he needs it, and it's like, I know that there are so many people like that, and so it's definitely abuse that they've taken those people who they know, you know, they've done all the testing to find out that these people are gullible to the sense and submissive to something like this. And then they've capitalized on it.
Right. And I know it's weird to compare it to the 1-800 numbers or Oprah. Yeah. And it's Scientology's on another level, but that is what it compares
it
to.
Is.
It's
are you
marketing
tired
first,
of being miserable?
100%. It's marketing first, and it's religion, you know, arguably never, but marketing first, religion second, community second, whatever. And they know how to market to you. And I wouldn't be surprised if big corporations go to them and say, hey, how
Absolutely.
Do we market the way that you market? You know,
yeah.
Because they do a hell of a thing with it. And you can say what you want about branding and marketing, and I would say, you know, bad things about it, but it works for them. It's clearly worked for them. And the litigation thing, which we'll talk about later, but the marketing thing for them is unbelievable. And they convince you that you need this, and they're not the only ones who do that. But on this level with religion, they probably are the only ones who do it to that degree, and that's why it's so weird. It's so strange.
It starts off so innocent. It even says in the very first paragraph of when you're introduced mm-hmm. to Scientology, it's Scientology is a you know, a conglomerate of solutions that are not specifically tailored to one person. If it's right for you, then great. If it's not for you, then great. You know, totally open, and it gives you this illusion of the freedom of choice to make your own decisions on what you believe in.
Right. Specifically, they said it does not work for everyone.
Right.
If it doesn't work for you, let it be.
Almost like exclusive. Like, oh, so it doesn't work for everyone, so I wonder if I could be one of them.
Well, it's kind of saying to you, hey, look, you're going to be safe throughout this. If any time you want to pull out, you can.
Freedom.
You know, like,
it's a soft sell. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a soft sell. So it's like anybody who does that to you, you're like, oh, I'm not sure if I want this dress or this clothing item or whatever, this couch. But they're like, oh, you can bring it back in 30 days. So it's like, okay, why not? You're going to make me a better me. You're going to help me get to this next level of awareness with myself, which I agree with to some degree, that maybe doing this auditing process in the beginning stages would really help some people reflect on events that maybe they haven't confronted. I can see the draw to that, but that's sort of no different to me than like a counseling session.
Yeah,
but it's except, not recorded to blackmail
yeah,
you
yeah,
later.
Exactly.
and there's also not a secondary motive to the counseling session.
Right.
I mean, maybe you could argue, oh, the counselor wants you in for more or whatever, but there's not that secondary motive of trying to get your money to raise funds beyond the services provided. That's the real issue with stuff like that. And Scientology, and it's also this, it's they misinterpret themselves as a religion. It's not a religion. I know they got their exemption. We learned why they got their exemption. It's not a religion. It's you know, maybe
it's a
nonprofit business, but it's
business.
Not a damn religion.
No, so. I mean, the fact I was so upset when I got to that point in the documentary, whenever they were having the IRS, they were going back and forth fighting the IRS and the power of Scientology. They got all their members to sort of make these lawsuits. They had 26 or something like that. No, it was like 2,600 lawsuits against specific IRS employees and then the IRS as a general company as well. And, you know, the commissioner was, like, going back and forth with David, who was in charge of the Scientology. And at the end of the day, the IRS surrendered because they didn't want to deal with all these lawsuits.
Right.
And by granting them, though, the title of being a religious entity, now they're protected by the First Amendment, which protects them from basically all these individuals that they abuse, which is so hard to me.
And the tax thing was a big issue for them, but it also underscores a bigger point in society about having connections, having resources, and the legal system. And you can work the legal system to your advantage because Scientology and the people who run it are not normal people. They are not you and I with our, you know, whatever bucks an hour jobs or whatever. That's not them. They're loaded. And they can work the legal system and put through so many lawsuits that the IRS says, you know what, it's not worth it to fight these, no matter how frivolous. We will just settle with you. We'll have a gentleman's agreement or a written thing or whatever. We won't pursue you. You don't pursue us. You get what you want. It's a done deal. That's the way the legal system works sometimes, you know, for the not normal people. And that's, you know, Scientology aside, they wrangled the American legal system to their advantage. And that's a shame, too. But here we are.
But that makes me think, what else are they wrangling for their own behalf? I mean, what kind of political power do they have? I don't know how many Scientologists there are in the world. I did not kind of look up that fact, but
they
it's
said,
like...
In the documentary, towards the end, they said that the number of active users has, or active members, has declined to around 50,000.
Okay.
So, you know, if anyone's out there, like, scared that the cult of Scientology is taking over the government, and, you know, I mean, it's not... I think people are generally intelligent and skeptical, and when something seems too good to be true or like a waste of money, usually people tend to flock away from it. So I feel like that's the
in
kind
this
of
day
cultural
and age.
Shift yeah, that we're seeing nowadays.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in the uproar of this whole revolution, mainly in the 80s, people were, reaching out for alternative ways to believe in something and how to better help themselves. And we find in this documentary the whole story of L. Ron Hubbard, which, you know, the way they paint him, you know, they don't paint him in glorious, you know, colors like the Church of Scientology does.
Nor should he have been. He was a science fiction writer. I mean, that's the other
thing. Science fiction writer, but also seems like...
And a kind of a criminal.
He's kind of...
Yeah, I mean...
And a very, very bad soldier, a very, very bad commander.
That's what I was going to say,
like,
yeah. He said he sunk two Japanese subs when actually he used all his power on his ship to sink a log in the ocean.
He sunk a subway sub.
He was discharged from military...
Yeah.
for making too many mistakes, and he turns around and tells stories at the bar to pick up chicks.
And I mean, wasn't even
who
like,
doesn't do that?
Wasn't court-martialed? Wasn't punished? They were just like, no, we just don't need you anymore.
Yeah.
You go
dismissed.
Home.
Yeah,
we got this big war to fight. You can sit at home. Like, that's how bad he was.
But I mean, he does have the Guinness World Record for writing over what 10,000 books? Is that what it was? Or over 1,000 novels? Something ridiculous.
I forgot the number, but it's definitely the most books ever published.
quantity over quality on that one.
I mean, so he got his practice in. You know, right. You write 10,000 books, and you start to develop these ideas that you truly believe in yourself. I think this was kind of an investigation to the beliefs of L. Ron Hubbard himself, and the discovery that he was trying to make about his own madness or genius or whatever it is that was going on in his head. He kind of purged it out to the world, and a lot of people could relate to what he had to believe in. Until you get to OT8.
Yeah.
Or was OT3?
Or even like 3,
OT8,
yeah.
I think it was. Yeah, or 3. But I had... Now, before we talk about this, I've had several people kind of tell me that, oh, you get to this level and then it's like aliens. But that's all I knew. It's like they would try to tell me, but I didn't really get it. So in this documentary, we get the real story that you get this handwritten file that you have to keep on lockdown.
Right.
And
so you're crossing this bridge. Right? You start off by taking these, you know, thetan level tests, e-meter tests, and you pay for these sessions over and over, and eventually, with enough money and dedication, you reach this point. It's OT, or outer thetan, I think is what it is.
Mm-hmm.
I might be wrong.
Yeah.
Right.
But you reach this sacred level on your way to enlightenment, and they... You get to a certain point, they bring out a locked briefcase with these handwritten memoirs from L. Ron Hubbard himself, the actual science fiction writer. And on these manuscripts detail the true history of human origin, human soul, and how it goes. So, and if you happen to be a South Park fan, they do an excellent job of kind of animating this this whole story. So if you get a chance, check out the Scientology episode of South Park. It's hilarious. But how it goes is around 75 million years ago, there was another planet far away where there were people that pretty much looked like us and lived kind of like we did in the 50s. Mm-hmm. And then there's this galactic overlord that takes over. His name is Xenu, right? And he takes these... who he deems to be criminals of the state, and he freezes their bodies and sends them on these giant Boeing-looking spaceships.
Yeah, they look like DC-9s. That's important, too. Because when he's writing these things, what commercial jets are being used? DC-9s.
Oh, yeah, it's whatever it's in his little world when he's writing it.
It's so stupid.
So he sends these frozen alien bodies to our planet, which is Earth, and throws these bodies in a volcano, and then blows them up with atomic bombs, and their souls get detached from their bodies and start flying around the planet. And finally, when mankind comes around, these souls, these thetans, attach themselves to our bodies, and that is what causes the stress and, I guess, the overall torment of the human soul, the suffering.
That's a nice way of saying it.
It's because we have alien souls from the galactic overlord Xenu, attached to our bodies that were also brainwashed by giant movie screens.
And did you catch, there's a very, very, very
did
important...
Did I get it?
Pretty much, you did. There's a very important distinction in there, too, that when a baby is born, one of those souls, one of those thetans, you know, attaches to the baby, but it's not a one-to-one ratio. Many can.
It could be many.
Like, so here's the distinction. So when you enter Scientology and they say, oh, you're really messed up, or you have this problem, you have that problem, they're pretty much at will to say, oh, you must have had 400 thetans attached to you. You know, and they can work you as long as they want to work you. Mm-hmm. If you're a bad, you know, if you go to their prison camp effectively, oh, well, you have a lot of thetans attached to you. You know, it's such an arbitrary process that they get to control. And you look at origin stories like that, and you can make, you know, depending on how cynical you are, you can make that skeptic's case about every religion's origin story for sure. People do. But you look at things like that, and it's not a one-to-one ratio of thetans attached, so really they could take advantage of you in any way that they want as long as you're game enough to keep doing it.
Yeah,
but if they there are people that's who the are. Thing though, if they sit you down from the very beginning and they say, okay, so
you have
the galactic
41.
Overlord Xenu is responsible for your alien thetan level, you'd be like,
Exactly.
Can I have my deposit back?
They need to ease you into it. They and when you're there, they say, oh, it turns out it's not one thetan for you. It's 72. So we're actually going to need $250,000. And you're like, well,
get the alien souls out of me.
I believe this now. You know, if you're not Paul Haggis, you believe it so much now, you have to do what you got to do, right?
It's weird. I mean, all right. Talking about, you know, the classification of religion, I mean, first of all, I don't know of any religion that requires you to pay to go to go to their church. I mean, that right there is the biggest red flag. I mean, believe what you want, but you shouldn't have to pay for it. But I think because of the fact that people in Scientology are paying for it, it's no longer a freedom of belief. The documentary kind of portrays this notion of you lose the ability to think for yourself. And now, what is really the difference between a belief and believing something for yourself?
Mm-hmm.
Like, is it indoctrinated into you, or is it something that you found, you know, through an inward journey?
Right.
These experiences that people go through. I mean, we're talking about, you said there wasn't many like new subjects brought to light. I never heard about the hole. There's this little prison camp inside the Scientology headquarters for the executives to live in. It's like the hole in Cool Hand Luke or Shawshank Redemption or something. They all hang out and get tormented. And
yeah, one guy had to use his tongue to mop up a bathroom floor as punishment. And they were talking about how they would sleep on wet mattresses. And
babies are taken off to a separate ward.
The cadets.
They're not taken care for very well. I mean, it slowly becomes a cult. And I feel like the difference between a cult and religion is the ability to choose for yourself what to believe in. Mm-hmm. Religions are all about freedom of belief, from my understanding of them. And Scientology, I don't think classifies. I think it's a cult.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of saw this whole thing
a business cult.
Yeah, for sure.
Right, I kind of saw the whole thing as, okay, at the beginning of the year, everyone buys a gym membership, right? And, like, they go because they're paying for it, and they feel bad when they don't go because they're paying for it. So it's like, when you're paying for something, you feel like you have to do it. You feel like you're wasting money if you don't get what you thought in your mind you were going to get when you gave that money. So I feel like these people are continuously going forward with it because they haven't yet achieved what they were told they were going to get. So it's like that whole thing when you're putting money in something, it really messes with your psychology.
I'm going to say something to that too. Another good metaphor for this kind of thing is you're playing poker, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you got maybe $10,000 to your name. All right. So somebody, you want to buy into the hand where you could make, let's say, $3 million. Like, that's your enlightenment. $3 million is your enlightenment. You win this hand, you pay in, but you got to pay in $4,000. All right, so you pay in $4,000, and then they're like, oh, well, to do the next hand, it's $150. Okay, well, I mean, I've already paid in $4,000. I might as well pay $150. And then, oh, the next hand's $500. All right, well, I've already paid in $4,150. I might as well pay in $500 because I don't want to take that as a loss.
Right.
Before you know it, weeks later, you're already out $10,000, and you haven't really received anything. You're just giving them money. They're getting more control over you. And then when you're in debt, you're dependent on them.
Right.
It's terrible. It's loan sharking at its finest.
Yeah,
it's,
I mean, they could
it's terrifyingly
but you're
efficient.
But you're one of the guys. You know, you're at the table. You're still playing poker.
Yeah, you're still there.
Playing the game.
Yeah, you're still sitting next to Tom Cruise and all these guys. You're chumming it up. You may be broke and owe the government several $100,000, but you know what? You got
Scientology plans. Did all their initial recruiting in Vegas.
Right.
Just kidding. So I want to talk about David. Is it McCavish?
Miscavige.
Miscavige. So he came into this whole thing when he was 11 years old. And I often think of this as like the religions overseas where these kids are raised to basically strap suicidal bombs to themselves, blow themselves up because of religious purposes. Now, the fact that David came in here when he was 11, I mean, he really believes all these lines, these lies that he's been told from Ron Hubbard.
Do we know that?
I don't know. I think, honestly, from a point where you're coming in as a child, I think you're so easily brain warped at that point. I don't know if now he's come to his senses, but if you think about it, I mean, like, those children overseas who strap the bombs to them, I kind of put him in the same seat. I mean, coming into something at age 11 and then being completely reliant on it, like a family for that long.
If you completely believe in something, you're not worried about your believers ruining everything.
Mm-hmm.
He wouldn't have been so paranoid about Tom Cruise not being a part of it if he fully believed it.
Right. Maybe he, like I said, recognizes that he shouldn't fully believe it, or that it's that it is lies and it's just a money-making scheme. But for me, I was also just thinking of it on the lines of, look, he was a child when he came into this. And, like, the abuse of being raised in a system like this where there's all these lies and no truths. I mean, that was what came across my mind. Hopefully he's woken up to the fact that it's just a money-making business.
Yeah, he never had a chance from the start either way. I wonder, and I would be interested in your perspective on this, all three of you, really. Was this a troll job from L. Ron Hubbard from the start? Do you ever wonder, knowing how ridiculous it is, this is a serious question, right. How ridiculous it is, do you ever wonder if he started saying, I wonder how far I can get with this? And then, you know, 20 years later was like, holy shit, people are so stupid. And I know that's a funny and weird thing to say, but seriously, it's so ridiculous. Is this a troll job from him? And then somebody like Miscavige, because we heard from Marty Rathbun, who was the PR guy, who kind of alluded to it. Somebody like Miscavige is terrified of losing it, understands the business implications, understands how to wrangle the legal system. That's not a religious thing. That's a business enterprise at that
point.
But I just can't help but wonder if L. Ron Hubbard's sitting there, you know, if he were still alive today, he'd be like, you got to be kidding me. How did you do this?
Yeah, I mean, I think he all along recognized what he was doing, because was it his wife Sarah, the one from the way
Sarah
beginning?
Northrop.
Yes, Sarah Northrop. I mean, she even said that he was writing the science fiction books and then combining them with the Dianetics and then parts of research that was true. And he mentioned to her that the fastest way and easiest way to make money was to create a religion. So it's like, I know that he knew from the very beginning what he was doing. But I just feel like because David came in as a child, yes, he's just as guilty. And I mean, obviously, like Steven said, knowing that your members are going to destroy it, he wouldn't probably feel that way if he didn't believe it wholeheartedly. But at the same time, the cadets and referring to Spanky and her rescuing her child from that sort of cadet environment, I don't know if David was... So we didn't get sort of his backstory, and was he in that cadet environment where those kids were in urine-filled beds and the mucus from their eyes had, you know, made their eyes shut and they couldn't open them? And I mean, just the description of her finding her child and there was maggots or flies all around the body. I mean, we don't know. That's what I was sort of asking, if David was sort of brought up in that cadet environment and that horrible housing. I don't know, but that would make anyone go crazy.
The things that the Church of Scientology can get away with because they are considered a church and religion are outrageous when you say stories like that, when this documentary brings them to light. But I don't think to answer your question, I don't think that is particularly what L. Ron Hubbard, as maybe demented as his imagination was, I don't think that was his goal. I think it started off, he has, 10,000 books written. This is a guy who is a pretty adept at writing, and he understands human psychology, he understands storytelling, he knows what people want to hear. But I think when he wrote Dianetics, he wrote it to be kind of a discovery into self. I think he has certain beliefs and understandings about, you know, how to live life in a joyous way and to live free from suffering. Buddhist mentality there, you know, let go of past sufferings and look to the future. I mean, it started off like that, and then it became pretty popular. New York Times bestseller. He even said he didn't expect to sell more than 6,000 copies.
I would be very careful with that quote. I think that quote, we know how people nowadays, we know how people nowadays game the bestseller list. It's everybody does it. If you're on the bestseller list, a lot of times you're gaming that list. Look at church groups buying books and stuff.
Sure.
I wonder with him about that quote is that's his way of being like, oh, I just tried this thing and the people loved it so much. Sure they did, pal. Okay. That's why I got 50,000 members now, right?
Yeah.
I don't think he could have anticipated how popular it got. I don't think anyone could have. I think that he's an experienced writer and he's used to cranking stuff out and for, you know, little to no money on each thing, you know, writing in the Depression. And then finally he writes something that gets really big and popular. Right, and so because it got so popular and because everybody out there seemed to believe it so much, that reinforces his belief in it. he starts to really believe what he's writing, mm-hmm. and then starts to be, you know, infused with this feeling of divinity, and maybe what I am saying, maybe I am channeling something greater. I mean, you have all these, you know.
So he's buying his own bullcrap.
Yeah, exactly.
But he bought his own books.
It's
all those copies.
I don't think so at all. I think straight and simply from the beginning, this was a satire on religion that he was like, let's see how far I can take this.
Yeah.
And if he can make money while he's doing it. I mean, you see the same kind of concepts employed in Hollywood every day. I mean, look at casting director workshops. Look at, like, these acting workshops. People will try to latch on to anything that can potentially bring them up. All he needed was a few successful people saying that it's great. And you get it. That's how Kanye sells $50 shirts that are no better than $10 shirts. Successful people latch onto it and want to climb up by their bootstraps. And it's terrifying because he literally looked at religion and say, what are these people believing in and how are they really being immersed in this? And he broke it down scientifically. Religion is a scientific formula. You can look at every religion that's out there and you can break down the parts of it that kind of get people involved. You have the community, you have the rules kind of thing, the be good to the others kind of thing. Every religion has a part. And what he did was he adapted that part to a story and attached big names to it. He commercialized religion. Mm-hmm. And when they sold that, you're in the Depression, you're in this time where a lot of people don't have money. A lot of people want to strive to actually get their American dream. A lot of people still believed in the American dream back then. So you have basically this product that's selling you salvation and the possibility of success in your career and your life. Like, and everyone just looks so happy in a time where everyone's so sad. Like, who wouldn't buy that cake? Who wouldn't want a bite of that donut?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
It's people jumped at it. It was kind of, now we see it every day with all the things that we deal with. But this was in a time where people hadn't really seen this very much before. Not on such a global, not a global, but like national scale. Because they had the funds to make it national. You see it here and there in America, but you didn't see it all across the country.
Right. Well, it definitely became that. And I think in the back of his head when he's writing Dianetics, I think, yeah, that might have been like, you know, the structure that he set up was, let me follow the, you know, the formula of religious and self-help because that's what people love. They eat it up. You know, I think he wrote it partially as like a discovery of self and what he believes in, but also how can I make this as appealing as possible to sell the most books. After it became super popular, I mean, what's the next step? Get religious status so I don't have to pay taxes. That's pretty much the point, right?
Right. Well, I mean, there was the part where he went mad and he kidnapped his child and he told his wife that, you know, he cut the child up into pieces and that he killed her. I mean, that's crazy. And then the other part that sort of made me feel, okay, maybe he's believing his own bullshit, is the part where he had the one guy wanting to make a machine that would kill his physical body. So basically suicide. So it's like, all right, he's got to be believing in to, you know, what he's writing at that point.
Sure. Well, you know what? To be honest, I'm somewhat skeptical of, you know, L. Ron Hubbard's wife's testimony, Sarah. You know, because it wasn't her voice. I'm sure it was just a written letter from some time ago. I just dropped in the Canadian accent. You hear that? Some time ago. And then, you know, these other guys that are attesting. I mean, I feel like most of the talking heads in the documentary were being pretty sincere with, you know, their personal experiences. But, you know, this was obviously a, what'd they say? I guess it's just a peaceful protest against a cult. So it is really one-sided. It's let's show the, you know, the crazy parts of L. Ron Hubbard, and let's show the crazy parts of Scientology, and like balance it out with a little bit of understanding of how it got to that point.
Well, they offered, you know, L. Ron Hubbard, or not L. Ron Hubbard, they offered David Miscavige and the church to speak, and they turned it down. So,
sure.
You know, there's only so much you can do on
that. They're busy making their own.
Yeah, they are. They're doing their own, and they would call this propaganda, no doubt. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. I think this underscores Scientology, whether it's this or, you know, 1-800 things that you're buying, you know, things you're buying late night infomercials from, or The Secret from Oprah. Dumb people are gonna do dumb things. It's just, it's, you know, Oprah's obviously far short of a religion, but is she?
No.
You know?
No.
Is she?
No. There's just no payment plan is all.
And there is a payment plan, and it's her book club, and it's all
you get eternal life, and you get eternal life.
It's if there's a takeaway on this film, I think there are two takeaways. But if there's a takeaway on this film, the first one is people are stupid. And I hate to say it, but you know, 80% of the people
in the 80s.
People are stupid.
Not anymore.
People are dumb now. People are dumb now. I mean, there's just a fact.
And there's always going to be people who succumb to like the easy answers, you know, peddling easy answers.
100%. It's the same. It's the same thing as Oprah. It's the same thing as 1-800. It's the same thing as blog posts nowadays. You know, five ways to do such and such in 2015. There are no five ways. You got to find out your own ways. Everybody's looking for the next great, easy, you know, bite-sized thing in
every
generation.
From behind their computer.
Yeah, and it's from behind your computer now and whatever. Now, the flip side of that is, and my other takeaway from this film is, nothing will change people being stupid. Thousands of years ago, they were dumb. Thousands of years from now, they will be dumb. But one thing that is going to change that conversation, at least with Scientology a little bit, is the internet. And how much information we all have at our disposal from documentaries like this now, that we look at Scientology not just as, oh, this is crazy, why would you ever get into it? We look at it as a joke. It's a joke to us. People laugh about stuff like this. And moving forward, the more that people see stuff like this on the internet and on things like HBO, and the more you have mass media that's so diversified to every little niche, you have people having conversations right now on Twitter about this and on Facebook about this documentary saying, Scientology's crazy. Why would you get involved with this? This is dumb, man. And that conversation, you know, it repeats itself over and over and over again with people all around the world. And when Scientology goes forward, you say they have 50,000 members and that's declining, it's gonna keep declining. It may not be a scandal that brings them down. It may not be whatever that brings them down. This documentary in and of itself won't bring them down. It's the general idea and the public relations kind of nightmare that they see from this documentary on top of everything else that's already come out.
Right. I think along with the stardom, I'm not sure. They showed Travolta sort of like being really into it, saying that like joy's the main obligation of this society or this religion, and joy isn't like the founding center of anything else, any technology, any religion. And he was so into it. And then after seeing what happened with his friend Spanky and her children being taken away and not being able, she couldn't have dinner with him, then he sort of left. And then we got the whole like Tom Cruise is the ambassador of the world. So, and they were trying to break up his relationships and basically control him and warping females to be his girlfriend. It's like, I do think of him when I think of Scientology. So they do have that stardom. But I think everyone sort of sees him being crazy because of his relations with Scientology.
And those two guys, Travolta and Cruise, have taken huge PR hits from regular people. Nope. I mean, I know Cruise is still a box office guy for his movies, but everybody thinks Cruise and Travolta are whack jobs right now for a lot of reasons. I mean, that's just the majority of the American public. Ask. Do a poll. Their Q scores are way lower than what they were 20 years ago. The
but
joke
how
is up
are
on
their
guys
feet
like that.
Levels doing
well but that's the joke with these guys. And unless they can find the next wave of stars, can they get, you know, Brad Pitt and Kim Kardashian? And you know, I doubt it, but that's the move. And if they can't,
well, see, the thing is, Scientology used to be appealing because it was mysterious. You know, you have people going in and coming out feeling happier, and what's this new thing? You know, let me read this book, Dianetics. Hey, that makes sense to me. That's neat. I can find solace in this community. And I think it's more not to the point that people are dumb, because you're right, people are dumb. Everyone's dumb. I'm kind of dumb sometimes, but I think my point is people are sad. You know, people a lot of people suffer, a lot of people are sad, and some people turn to religion for the answers. Some people turn to family. Some people, unfortunately, drugs and alcohol and criminal activities, whatever it may be. But Scientology was just one of those outlets that people could plug into and find solace, find peace or joy, or at least relief from some sufferings that they have in their life, because everyone has them. But I think at a certain point, there was a turning point when... You know, I guess the whole galactic overlord alien souls thing came out.
And that the prisoning kind of their members.
And the abusive practices of the church. I mean, once people start to see that the mystery, the veil of mystery behind L. Ron Hubbard's, you know, Scientology was pulled down, and you can kind of see it for what it is as a science fiction novel and a business based on the practices of cult, then you start to turn off from turn off from it real fast, and then you see the decline going down. I mean, the church is still worth billions of dollars.
Yeah, their top three is worth like $1 billion each. That's insane, and there's 20 of them.
That's what they say. Who knows what they're really worth, you know?
That's true.
But it's it starts off, I think, as innocent, you know, as anyone walking into the door of a therapist's office, and it ends either with you being disconnected from your family or just totally enveloped by the life of being a Scientologist. And I think for the latter, it's on the decline. And thank goodness for that, right?
Yeah. I mean, I think I'm glad that they made this documentary. I feel like, you know, I was enlightened about what it really was, what the story was, the progression of it, how it started and where it ended. And it brings light to a lot of information that, you know, the average person probably didn't know before. I didn't really look into it like you did, Bobby. I mean, I had only heard rumors when people would mention it, and it was this mystery that I was attracted to. And like I said, when a few times I went by their parties, and it's like I kind of just wanted to go because there was a lot of money put in those parties. Like, everyone was dressed to the nines, there was all these lights, and it was like very attractive to the eye. And not like I would actually go into it, but I was always curious. So I think, if anything, this documentary definitely dispels that curiosity for a lot of people, and the mystery is gone, and sort of you get to see what you bought from the infomercial actually breaking and not working.
Doesn't absorb crap.
No! Yeah, so for me, that takeaway was just like, okay, the mysteries have unraveled, mm-hmm. and now I know what it is. Right. So, any takeaways for you, Ryan?
I'm about to be taken away in an unmarked van.
Yeah, they did mention how a journalist was writing a story on Scientology, and his dog was poisoned during that. So, I mean, it is scary, and they used all the blackmail, you know, that Travolta gave in his little auditing sessions against him to make him stay in and stay silent.
Obviously, those are signs too. If you mm-hmm. can't convert members the right way, and you got to do it the wrong way, that should tell you something. And they know that, and that's the sign of them running scared more than anything.
Running scared when they're just trying to go clear. And by the way, going clear is the phrase used to basically reach the top level of enlightenment, where you're clear of thetans, and you're at peace.
You guys are just a bunch of SPs. Can't deal.
I guess just a takeaway. I've basically discovered Scientology is just a journey into the mind of L. Ron Hubbard that became more of a business than a religion after his death, in which we can see that parallel in all the religions of the world. After the prophet dies, all of a sudden the religion becomes an institution that might not stand entirely for what the prophet himself or herself did. Mm-hmm. And we see it just so happen to happen in our modern age. It's just a religion that sprung up in the 1900s instead of 1000 BC or whenever.
Yeah.
And it was short-lived because it was clearly more about money than answers. And when you are playing with people's beliefs, people can get real blind to it real quick, and a lot of dangerous things can happen. We've seen it happen all over the world, and I like how Going Clear presented the entire story the way an unbiased person needs to see it. Because mm-hmm. It didn't attack Scientology too hard, but it also didn't, you know, endorse it too much either. It just kind of gave the insight into the people who invested most of their lives into it.
Right.
I think those are the people that you should trust when listening on any subject.
Yeah, because, I mean, even in the interviews, these people will tell you that their lives are destroyed. They were never like, whatever you do, don't join Scientology. They never said that.
No,
they were
like,
just telling you their experience.
Yeah, if you're an intelligent person, you're skeptical, it's easy to see how Scientology could help in the beginning. But don't get too far deep, because there's no escape.
Yeah.
This will happen again. There's another person doing another thing like this right now. It'll happen 20 years after this. It'll happen 20 years after this, because it's happened through all of time. You know, look at the time when Jesus was alive. For Christians out there who are Christian historians, look at the time when Jesus was alive. There were hundreds of guys going around doing what he was doing. You know, this will always happen. This will happen 100, years from now, and it will be somebody different in some other wrinkle in some other realm, and there's going to be a ton of people who buy into it, because they always are.
Did you hear about the new one? Ryantology.
Of course.
Join today!
Oh, Jesus. Well, I'm glad that we covered this, and hopefully we provided some clear content for you guys at home. You can follow The Popcorn Talk at The Popcorn Talk on Twitter and on Instagram. You can watch us live at popcorntalk.com every Sunday. Please download, rate, and subscribe. We're also on iTunes. And I'm Kristen Elizabeth Snyder, and you can follow me at Cinematic Escape.
Thank you again for joining us. I'm Ryan Malady. You can follow me at Ryan Malady everywhere, unless Scientologists come find me and take me away. If I'm not on Twitter in the next 3 days.
You know what happened.
Check Hollywood Boulevard.
Oh, God.
And I'm Bobby DeMiro. You can find me on Twitter at Bobby DeMiro.
Thanks, guys, and we'll see you next Sunday at 5 p.m.
From producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire Popcorn Talk Network, we would like to thank you for tuning in. For questions or comments, be sure to visit popcorntalk.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of the Popcorn Talk Network.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of the Popcorn Talk Network or its owners or principals.